Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:03 p.m. Central Time on the 14th of February, 2019. It is Thursday here in the States, Friday already internationally. It was Valentine's Day, and if you celebrate the holiday, I hope you had a good one. Well, we're here to talk about seismic events. Let's turn on a display capture, and if you're a new viewer, I'll quickly explain. We're using the USGS combined with the EMSC out of Europe to give us a good picture of the earthquakes that have struck around the planet. We're looking at 48 hours worth of activity. Actually, not even that, almost 36 hours right here. And the older earthquakes are marked in a pinkish color, and the younger earthquakes over the past few hours are marked in white. And the higher the earthquakes are off the globe, the deeper they are into the earth. And we've got some activity to talk about today. Rare 6.2, 6.1 earthquake striking just south of the Azores on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Also a 5.3 coming in on the northwest tip of Vancouver Island, Canada. And man, look at what's going on in the West Pacific over in Philippines going into Indonesia and Papua New Guinea. So I think that's where I'm going to start. Let me get the darker colored earthquakes out of there. This is what struck basically since my update last night. So that earthquake on the southeast coast of Japan is kind of where we dropped off. But look at this. Now I'll read off the magnitudes to you, but there's something similar about most of these magnitudes. They're between 4.9 and 4.5. So there's a few variations on that, but 4.9, 4.7, 4.0, 4.6, 4.5, 4.4, 4.3, 4.7, 4.5 all the way on the eastern perimeter, then sandwiched in between all of it, 4.9, 4.3, 4.4, 4.5 again, and then up to the north, 4.7, 4.8, 4.9. But look at it. Now, usually, we don't see clusters like this across such a vast area. To compare in size, here's the size of the United States, and here's the size of the area that's moving. It's about double the United States. So it's a huge region that has been displaced, and this is just within the last day, basically. So what's going on here? Obviously, a big displacement is taking place, but will that result in an extremely large earthquake? I don't want to panic anyone. I don't want to cause any kind of international rumble or freak out by everybody. I want everybody to watch for the potential of an extremely large earthquake to strike. Where? Most likely we would see an earthquake strike at our fulcrum point in between the middle of all this, and we would see large activity on the perimeter going to the west and to the north. So for instance, this big open silent zone to the north of this, all of this moving, imagine the combined total of a whole continent moving in a day, or a whole portion of a plate moving in a day is a better way to put it. And then we go up here to the north and we have a silent zone, and we go over here to the west and we have a silent zone. But this earthquake here stops right next to Mount Krakatoa. Also, Mount Kerinci started to erupt here in Sumatra. Doesn't normally show up on the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Over to the east, where this 4.5 is, right next to it, Manam volcano just sent off a new blast. I think 20-something thousand foot high blast. Let's go find out. Let's go take a look at the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. All right, yeah, Manam, 16,000. Was it just 16? It was 24. Okay, well, 16,000 foot high blast at Manam, Fuego, Guatemala, Planchon Petoro at the Chile-Argentina border, Popocate Patal in Mexico, Poas in Costa Rica, Chvalush in the Kamchatka Peninsula of Russia, Ducono, Popocate Patal, Nevados de Chilean, Mandam again, Turrialba is back on the list. Okay, that's on top of Poas right next to it. Reventador a few times in Ecuador, Fuego, Planchon Petoro, Poas again. No eruption, just blowing ash at Cordon Call, so we don't count that. Nevados de Chilean again, puff emissions and gases, Turrialba. This is all today. Wow, look at the list. Etna, Sabankaya. That's a pretty long list for one day's time, I would have to say. So today's list, extremely long, with many eruptions happening across the board. So we're increasing in the number of eruptions and at each volcano. Hey, new deep earthquake has popped off here. Let's get the time on this. 20 minutes ago. 20 minutes ago, a new deep earthquake just struck here on our letter D. This comes in at 582 kilometers deep. Now, we told everybody to watch for this 2 days ago. We told you there was an input of a 4.8 to 4.9 here, and that this would travel through the planet and come back out on the opposite side of the antipode with a new deep earthquake popping off. Well, here's our cycle restarting again. Here you get to see it now live as the earthquake has just been reported. So a 4.8 coming in here, deep down below the plate, coming across from the underside of the planet, or the other side of the planet, and hitting the underside of the plate here. 4.8 in here, 4.8 out here. Didn't lose much force at all going through the planet, did it? Kind of makes you question about what's down inside the planet, doesn't it? So when I see Indonesia, I'm going to have to tell you, I would look right into the middle of this whole hot mess. This brings us right into the spot that had the megaquake 4 months ago, 5 months ago, and it created a tsunami. So that's a pretty big deal in the location. I want you to watch just for the potential of a very large earthquake going up into, let's say, and this is going to be a complete flip on my forecast. Well, I shouldn't say a complete flip, but I would watch going into this coming week. So right now, I'm going to tell you to start watching, but I'm not going to issue a warning or a forecast for it until Sunday night. Okay, so next week, I would think that this is going to get really big. I hope I got the time frame on that right, because if it... Now, it could fizzle out and go away. That's why I'm not issuing any kind of alarm warnings or anything. I'm not ringing a bell or anything. But when I see something like this, I have to tell you about it. Like tonight, I'm tired. I was debating, should I get on? I could cover this 5.0 on the West Coast. But then I thought about this. I thought, man, it would be remiss of me, because if a large earthquake were to hit right in the middle of this tonight or tomorrow, I would feel bad for at least not telling you guys that something's going on here right now. Again, you can see something's going on here. What's going on? There was a disturbance down below the plate. Now, the USGS didn't report the deep earthquake that was here. We had to get it from the Europeans, but you can still see the other deep quakes up here in Japan and the one that's just been reported here down below Fiji. You'll also see a dramatic missing zone, silent zone, open area, whatever you want to call it, giant area missing earthquakes. And across, let's say, Eastern Solomon Islands, all of New Caledonia, going back up to Tonga, where our deep earthquake is, and then going down into New Zealand. Now, New Zealand has smaller earthquakes, so we can show those to you in a minute, but I'd like to show you the earthquakes yesterday, so you can see how this progressed from here over to here. So the energy that was generated down below the plate, here, let me show it. Here they are, marked in a reddish color. Look, all fives hammering over to the location and then stopping right here, right in the middle of it. So starting here, let me back it out, going up and over and stopping here, and then boom. So the force was generated and it's reached here and it has not progressed out of this region. That's why I'm starting to raise my eyebrows a little bit at this and think about the potential of large earthquake activity as a result of this. The last time we saw something like this, this many different fours in the course of a few days' time, building up into swarms across a whole area, believe it or not, we have to go back all the way to 2011 to the Japan megaquake, when we saw a whole section go into motion from down here at Okinawa, up past onto the shores of northeast Japan, and it was all fours. So the distance was huge. It was, or actually it went up even further to the north, even went up into the Kuril Islands, I think, but I don't know if people were even keeping track of that. But that size area from here to here is roughly the same size as from here to here. So we're talking about the same distance across. I'm not saying it's going to lead to a megaquake yet. I'm just watching it really, really close. So let's jump out of the West Pacific and go across China, go across Russia. And what do we have to report out of China and Russia? Oh, just another day where there's no earthquakes at all. You know, totally normal. You know what really bothers me about this is that I was showing you guys the earthquakes that were striking. They were being reported by the Kazakhstani agency, and they were being studied on the back end by seismologists on the seismologist study page over at the Europeans. But when I showed it to you, it caused a big international stink, and all kinds of people started to freak out over it. People started to make videos, make phone calls, contact people, and so forth. And they removed the NNC entirely now. They've cut the NNC, who was by proxy reporting the Chinese and Russian earthquakes. So here's what I propose to you, any person who's science-minded. Do you believe whole continents go quiet for weeks on end? Do you believe that the only time that we report earthquakes out of China and Russia is when it makes the news? Now look, I would hate to have to ask you to believe anything in science, but I just want you to think about that. No earthquakes across China and Russia again today. And I'm saying again today because it was the same way yesterday. Yeah, Mother Nature just stops across whole continents. Isn't it weird how they're all in an alliance, a financial alliance called BRICS? Isn't that weird? That the earthquakes stop in the countries that join BRICS. It's like maybe we need to join BRICS so the earthquakes will stop in our country. Let's go over across Iran, where last night's 4.2, you can still see it there. I'm more interested in what struck across Europe today. Now, if you caught my update earlier today, you probably got a kick out of what we found up in the UK, which we'll get into in a moment. But first things first, an equal spread of threes, 3.4 over in Romania, 3.3 down in South Italy, and then going up and across North Italy, of course, you see an equal distance space of earthquakes, central and north. And up here to the north in Slovenia, next to Croatia, two separate earthquakes about the same size, 1.6 and 1.5. Now, before we get into our rare 6.2 out by the Azores, look at our fracking earthquake up here in the UK. Now, I had to go over to Frack Off to go get the information, and I did this in my update earlier, so you guys can go watch that. I'm not going to delve into this too hard, but let's just say in the South UK, let me show you the spot where the earthquake happened, and then you guys can just, well, you can take it from there. Here's Crawley, and I'm going to put the coordinates in, so there's no question that this is where the earthquake occurred. There we are. Northwest of Crawley at Newdigate, but really, we're 6 miles away from Dorking, the town of Dorking, D-O-R-K-I-N-G. So we're Dorking out over to the east, or we're over to the east of Dorking. We're going out of Dorking. And what are we looking at? We're looking at a drill point. Now, there's shale exploration going on here, confirmed. You can go over to the Frack Off site. I showed it in my video earlier today, and go get the drill permits and the companies that are doing it. I'm not looking to chastise anybody. But it's activity going across South UK. No shock. We just got a push coming out of South Europe and Mediterranean in the 4.8 level. That was a day and a half, 2 days ago. Let's see if that's even still on here. Yeah, it is. Let's get all our smaller earthquakes out of there. There it is. There's our 4.8. So we got a push, and that push coming across, but then, boom, out here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, man, I'll tell you what, a 6.1 to 6.2, this is rare. We don't normally get activity this size out here. I'm looking where it came from, and the only place that I can look back to is over to the east. And over to the east, well, this gets us into what's coming out of Africa and the under-reporting, or no reporting, I should say, of earthquakes. So getting our coordinates here and putting the coordinates in on Google Earth. Oh, wait. Let's go click on their map and turn on the tectonic plates and U.S. faults. But U.S. faults isn't really going to help us much. As a matter of fact, we don't even need the U.S. faults. Tectonic plates. You see it here, big, whoops, big thick red line. And that big thick red line goes back over to the east and meets up with the Straits of Gibraltar, North Africa, and going across over this way. Well, also you'll notice no connection point over to North America. So the Mid-Atlantic Ridge is a fracture point that goes from North Pole all the way down to the South Pole. And you can see it's right off our T intersection coming out of Europe. So we need to go back over to the east. What's been striking over in Europe? We'll take it back a notch, and I'm going to put the coordinates in now for the actual quake. See if there's any undersea mounts of any kind there, any kind of volcanoes. Very well could be. Ah, well, we're on the Pico Fracture Zone, southwest of several Smithsonian-marked volcanoes at the Azores. Pico Fracture Zone, July 9, 1865, the crew of a whaling ship observed a submarine eruption. Floating pumice reached the ocean surface, where it formed a large floating mountain. A strong odor of sulfur was noticed, and dull rumblings were heard at intervals of 1 hour. Yeah, wow, okay, well, floating pumice islands out here coming up from deep down below. Our depth here is 8 to 10,000 feet deep. So if there's mountains coming up, just let you know how big the volcanoes out there are. So a 6 out there, look, how far are we from the volcanoes themselves? That's pretty far. That is pretty far. Let's get a measurement. From the Pico Fracture Zone, 200 miles, 250 miles from the center of the Fracture Zone. The Fracture Zone goes all the way over. It's 200 miles. Now, are there others? Well, there's a Fracture Zone right here. Makes you wonder, is there something going on, volcanically speaking, out there next to the Azores? Hope not. We'll know if big waves start to show up in the next several days, if anything else starts to happen here. But I look back over to the east, and I start to wonder. We had activity coming up out of Africa. We have radio silence out of, well, the whole continent, and that's pretty normal. They try to tell us no earthquakes strike across Africa normally. That it's seismically inactive, and it just doesn't have earthquakes. That's what they say. Same with Antarctica. It's a load of crap. If you believe that, man, just get out of here. Same with China and Russia. If you think that earthquakes just stop, I mean, you can hang out and learn something, but I don't know. I'm not interested in convincing you. So, yeah, you see one earthquake here? Yeah, one earthquake in a whole month or something. And down in Antarctica, no earthquakes ever reported, even though it's a whole continent with volcanoes. Active. Where did it come from? Where did it come from? I've been asking this question since the earthquake struck earlier today. I looked at the volcanoes and wondered, okay, maybe the volcanoes are playing into this, or maybe the other possibility is that the earthquakes that struck down here in Turkey and in South Europe were larger. Could very well be that these were a series of fives coming out across China and Iran. They've been doing some funny business, and I've been talking about it at length, so this shouldn't be a shock to anybody. They've been doing downgrade funny business. To put it in perspective, we had a 6.1 earthquake strike here. They took it down to a 4.9. There it is. So this 4.9 originally came in at a 6.0 to 6.1 energy transferring across. So am I shocked to see a 6.2, 6.1 earthquake out here when we had a 6.1 earthquake in the Indian Ocean that they took down to 4.9? I wouldn't be surprised if they tried to take this one down to a 4.9. Maybe they will. Maybe we'll wake up tomorrow and we'll wake up and they'll do the same thing. But the energy is transferring across the plate. That's what I'm getting at here, regardless of the downgrade. As we go up across our open areas, again, we have giant open areas with no earthquakes in them right now. Those should be filled in. That's in my forecast for this week. As we go up to the north, multiple fours. This is all from yesterday, technically. You can see multiple fours have struck across Kamchatka, going over into the Central Aleutian Island chain. How about that? If you watch my forecast, you should know to watch the middle points for a release. Also, make note, Chvaletsk is erupting here. Sakurajima technically is erupting here. I don't think it's on the list for today, but you can get a good look at it. Let me hit refresh on this thing. See if we got a good view of it. Yeah, we've got some ash there, but nothing big, so it's not on the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Going down to the south, this is where we start to get a little bit more hairy. We have Dukono volcano erupting here. We have Carinci, which erupted here. Over to the east, we have Manam erupting here. Whoops, erupting here in Papua New Guinea. So multiple new eruptions, multiple earthquakes across the area where the disturbance is taking place. And then we get up to the north, we get into mainland Alaska. I mean, what? A single earthquake? This is, again, you start to get to the level where a single earthquake on mainland Alaska in the course of a whole day, while the rest of the plate starts to go into overdrive with new eruptions, new deep earthquakes, and entire regions moving twice the size of the United States, and then a 2.5 today. Well, I'm curious about that, but before we get into mainland Alaska, let's quickly jump into Central and South America. Again, throughout the day. Yesterday, we were dealing with a huge line of fours going into this morning, going all the way down to the south tip of South America here. Well, look what happened today. I mean, like clockwork, a new 4.9. Again, 4.9. We laughed about this last night in my update. Now here we are, and a new 4.9 has popped up in the South Sandwich Islands. Where did it come from? It came from all the 4.9s to the north. Same distribution of energy. That's really where it came from. So it's not that a 4.9 all the way up here in South America causes a 4.9 down here in the South Sandwich Islands. It's that the 4.9 up here in South America and the 4.9 down here at the South Sandwich both caused by a distribution of force across the whole region, dropping off these 4.9s along the way. But they're not 4.9s. That's another controversy, which is all these 4.9s that are striking around the plates that are being reported as 4.9s, I should say, are really in the 5-ish range, 5.0, 5.1, 5.2. And the USGS is deliberately downgrading each 5.0, 5.1, 5.2 to a 4.9. I call it padding the numbers. It's like a meteorologist who issues a forecast and says there's only going to be X amount of rain today, and then a greater amount falls. They go out and pick up the rain gauge, tilt it over, tip out a little water, put it back down, and say, see, there's no increase or there's no greater amount than what we were looking for. It would be padding the numbers or falsifying the numbers. Also, a lot of people have apps which give the emergency managers have apps which give them updates at 5.0 and greater. A lot of people set their apps also just to get updates on 5.0 and greater. So if they can manage to keep each 5 down below 5, right to 4.9, it then prevents many people from even knowing what's going on, and their apps don't even show it. So there's many different layers to this, but every layer goes down deeper into something that smells extremely bad. And you can see an equal distribution of force across the whole continent, and in the middle of it all, last night's earthquake that struck right in the middle of the broadcast. Let's get that out of there. Boom. And here's what's hit since. As we go again into the continental United States and Central America, Central America has multiple new eruptions. Popocatépetl in Mexico here. Fuego here in Guatemala, Poes and Turrialba both erupting in Costa Rica, Reventador erupting here in Ecuador, Sabancaya erupting here in South Peru, Nevados de Chile and Planchon Petorol both erupting here in Chile. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 volcanoes erupting simultaneously across this area that just got hit with all the earthquakes. Now the earthquakes start to slow down and the eruptions start to pick up. This is going to all translate over to the east again. Eastern Caribbean should light up in the next couple days, and we should see new larger activity, anything larger than what's currently here on the map now. Now I mentioned one earthquake in Alaska is extremely odd. It's abnormal. Let's go take a look and see if there are smaller events any microquakes. Let's look at our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed. Now, professionals came out just a week ago or so and announced that they have figured out a potential way to predict or forecast earthquakes. The University of Oregon has pronounced that, and, well, they're basing it on smaller earthquakes. Go figure. A fundamental principle for earthquake forecasting that we've put out over many years' time for the last 8 years, well, a section of that is now somewhat, I think, being used by professionals. Maybe not our method, but just that they are using smaller earthquakes to determine when larger earthquakes are striking on the coast of Oregon now, or trying to. Now look at Alaska when we look at our microquakes. Tells an entirely different story. You check the USGS regular feed for 2.5 and greater, it shows one earthquake. But here you can clearly see there's a spread of activity across the whole, well, I would call this the peninsula all the way out here, and then going across the mainland. It stops next to Mount McKinley just to the east, and you'll see we are swarming up in Anchorage. Now this is a change from where we were a day ago. So we're swarming now in Anchorage. I'm expecting Anchorage to go up. So Anchorage should actually increase in magnitudes. We're already increasing the number of earthquakes at Anchorage. So get ready for it, guys. You've got a new 5 incoming throughout the week. And I think there may be a large earthquake striking in the Aleutian Island chain over the next several days by the end of this weekend. So I think it could go up to the upper 6 level. We'll wait to see. Have to wait to see with what's going on now over in Indonesia. Let's go into Hawaii. Mahalo for everybody in Hawaii, but take a look. What are we doing today? Well, we're on the southeast flank of Mauna Loa, and we go down across, actually at Kilauea today. We have a few earthquakes, and then down along the coast again of the Middle East Rift Zone. One lone event out at Lo'ihi, out here off the coast. So let's just quickly show you all this. If you're a new viewer, I don't want to get into a lecture, so I guess you're just going to have to come along with us and understand what I'm talking about. If you're a longtime viewer, this is like a repeat broken record, so no party is served tonight by what I'm showing you here. But I got to show you anyways. Series of earthquakes striking down here on the southeast side of Mauna Loa. One happening down here at Lo'ihi, and that's a change from where we were, which was yesterday up here at Mauna Kea, off to the eastern side. And a few days ago, we were out at Hualalai and down to the east by southeast along the coast on the edge of this Middle East Rift Zone, which is connected to Kilauea, which has collapsed. Kilauea collapsed, drained out, and it's repressurizing. It's rebuilding in magma, which is causing new earthquakes. As the force spreads out across the underside of the island, the big island, it hits these other magma chambers. So there's a disturbance, a displacement that's happening. Starting at Kilauea with the depression that fell down a few thousand feet and made the magma chamber a few thousand feet smaller. Now when new magma is coming in, it's spreading out to the other volcanoes, causing earthquakes along the way. No doubt about it. Now is it going to lead to an eruption? Yes. I think months. They think it's done. I don't know why. I do not know why they think the eruption is done. It's only half done. It drained out. It collapsed. Now it's going to repressurize, refill, and blast, forming a new crater, just like all the others. So sometimes there's just a collapse. Sometimes there's a collapse and a blast. Now this would be a case of a collapse and blast. Why? Because the crater's gone and 3/4 of the caldera is gone. 3/4 of this collapsed, not just the crater, not just the lava lake. The whole thing went kaput down into the center of the Middle East Rift Zone, or the top of it. Now it's repressurizing, and the center of this is rising as well, apparently, or probably. I say probably because they stopped doing science there. Complete lack of science, and I mean observational science. With volcanology, you've got to observe, and they are not observing visually. No flyovers, no pictures, no nothing. And that stopped back November, right at the time when the tourist season started. So what happened in California and here on the west coast of the United States? Well, exactly what we were expecting to happen. Everything that we were expecting to happen has now begun to take place. Yellowstone has started to swarm, Take a look at our stacks of earthquakes here. So I think you can see it. Look at this cluster going up into Idaho, over next to the park, right at the western entrance, down to the south, down in southeast Idaho. Big cluster compared to where we were yesterday, as well as a cluster down here, down in Utah. This is at Farron, Utah. And we looked that up yesterday and this morning. I'll look these up again. But just telling you, big clusters of earthquakes all of a sudden. And look in northwest California at geysers. Look at this. So yesterday, the stack was maybe 10 or 15 earthquakes. Now, I mean, the frequency has gone through the roof. So frequency equals the number of earthquakes. Magnitude, the power, has also gone up. It's up to 2.8, 2.7, multiple 2.6s, 2.7s, 2.8s. And then zeros and ones, of course, mixed in. So this is swarming. This is swarming. Utah swarming. Northern California swarming. And together, the combined total up here around Yellowstone going into Montana, that's also swarming. So what do these spots up here in Montana, going down through Idaho, down into Utah, what do those have in common? Well, take a look. Edge of the craton. One more time. Montana, down through Wyoming, down through Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, and Texas. Look at the deformed outside edge of the craton, the purple, where the purple meets that tannish, brownish color. So the inside edge of the craton is stable. The outside edge, where the mountains are, of course, is unstable. The unstable portion allows for force to travel across it, and it drops off earthquakes all the way along the way, all of the same size. As we go over on the far west coast up into Washington, 2.8 and a 1.1. But man, what about that 5.1 earthquake? I mean, come on. Or 5.3, I mean. Well, this 5.3 is listed today. It's listed in the last 24 hours, striking on the 14th. Well, it's now technically the 15th, so it's over 24 hours old. So it's not going to be on today's earthquake feed anymore. Do you follow me? So a 5.3 striking up here today means new energy is going to be coming down across the plate. Now let me turn our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed back on. And again, here's 24 hours. So now you'll understand why California is flaring up. We just had a new 5.3 energy worth of energy introduced up here to the northwest. That's going into the Juan de Fuca fracture zone. It transfers then into the plate and hits on the edge of the craton. Okay, so craton edge makes a big difference. You got to pay attention to it and the earthquakes that go across it, even in California. As we go down across over to the east, you're going to see the earthquake from last night. This is technically last night around 11 o'clock. This 2.6 struck and this 2.6. Both 2.6s coming in on the edge of the craton again. One of them at a drill point. The other at a possible volcano in southwest Missouri. Down near Mountain View or Mountain Home. Mountain View, Missouri. So Mountain View has rhyolite deposits. Well, we'll see. We'll find out more about that. I don't want to get too hard into that either. But over on the far west coast now, we get into Washington. And these two distinct quakes going on both sides of the Puget Sound, this 2.8 in the Olympic Peninsula, two small quakes, technically this 1.1 on the Seattle Fault or just south of it. Another day where there are no earthquakes reported out of Oregon. How many days are we going to go before we really start to get a good answer as to why they aren't reporting earthquakes daily out of Oregon when we know they must be striking? What you would see is a connecting line of earthquakes going down across Oregon, connecting from Washington to Oregon, into Northern California even. So this spot here, let's go pull the coordinates. Northern California is what the Europeans call it. What does the USGS call it? They call it geysers, 7 kilometers west by northwest of the geysers. And what's at the geysers? Well, of course, geysers. What makes geysers? Geothermal heat in the ground. What causes heat in the ground? Magma. Magma from a volcano, obviously. And the volcano is right here, Clear Lake. So Geyser Peak right next to Clear Lake, and the earthquake next to Geyser Peak, and next to the earthquake, geothermal pumping operations and pipelines. Pipelines go to the drill points. The drill points go down a few hundred to a few thousand feet to get that excess steam. Okay. So when we look at earthquakes and we see a stack of earthquakes at a volcano and that volcano has been drilled, you start to understand why the earthquakes are striking there. So we got energy introduced into the northwest portion of the plate via the Juan de Fuca, and then all of a sudden the portions on land that are weak points start to go into motion. As this energy is absorbed, it reaches out to the weak points, Craton Edge, volcanoes, and drill points. So what's up here in Northern California? A 0.9 and a 0.6. I can certainly tell you that this is low activity up to the north in California. It really is. So we would expect to see more earthquake activity in the next few days now that a new 5.3 struck up to the far northwest. This is taking us to Mineral California. Boiling Springs Lake. Well, I mean, that kind of settles it where we're at. Boiling Springs Lake next to Sifford Mountain volcano. Sifford Mountain, a basaltic to andesitic shield volcano, rises in south central Lassen National Park. It was probably active during the past 100,000 years, according to Klin in Wood and Kinley, 1990. Well, there's Sifford Mountain. Here's Lassen Peak. So I would say Lassen is the greater stratovolcano, isn't it? Is it a stratovolcano? Ah, well, it's huge. It's massive, guys. And it is right on the edge of that at Boiling Springs Lake. This is the one. That's interesting. I bet it is. I bet it gets its name because it really does have a boiling spring. Or did. Who knows? Don't have a Dante's Peak moment. Don't go diving in. As we go down along the coast, we see an equal distribution of earthquakes going from south of the Bay Area, starting in the South Hayward Fault or the north creeping section of the San Andreas, and then going east of Monterey Bay, and then in the middle of all of it, a near 3.0 earthquake, 2.7, 2.8. Then going further down to the south, we jump over to the east. So we go in a diagonal line following the San Andreas, then we jump over into the valley. Why? Why are we jumping over to the valley again? And I say again, because this is now a repeat thing. It's like a train coming down a track and then jumping off the track. Why? If we're going down the San Andreas, why would we be drawn over into the valley suddenly at this point? Well, right here, you'll see all these roads and these pads. All the roads and pads are going to different oil and gas pumping operations. So oil and gas. Now, this is getting hit with small earthquake activity, just like what's going on over in the UK, South UK. Their drill points are getting hit. Here, our drill points are getting hit. Over in Russia, their drill points are getting hit. Over in Saudi Arabia, their drill points are getting hit. We're not getting reported those quakes, but I guarantee you they are. Every country that's doing this, up in Canada, they've got to be getting hit. Brazil, they've got to be getting hit. It's just we are being kept in the dark. There's no doubt about it. You will never convince me otherwise. So this spot here, guess what's right next to it? I just showed you the drill points, right? All of this. All of these drill points here. Thousands of them going down hundreds to thousands of feet and spreading out miles. Guess what's right next to this? Parkfield. Here, the earthquake capital of the world, as they call it. And here's the diagonal line that makes up the San Andreas. And that is the diagonal line of earthquakes that goes past Monterey Bay up into the Bay Area itself. There's our line of quakes being drawn over to the drill point. Now we can skip over all of Eastern California, which is highly abnormal for 24 hours. Highly abnormal for us not to get any earthquakes over here at Lake Tahoe and to the north up at Reno and to the south. So all of this, quiet? Yeah, we're getting a little, my eyebrows are raised heavily with what's going on right now around the planet. as we get down here, though. We know what's at this location. This is a spot called Tom's Place. It's just to the east of Mammoth Mountain. Mammoth Mountain is a ski resort. It's a volcano, and I show it nightly. It gets hit daily. Why does this volcano get hit daily? It's a question you should ask. It's a question no one is asking. Why are these volcanoes getting hit daily with earthquakes? It's because I've figured out, at least on my end. Now, you can disagree with me all you want, but it makes logical sense. You have a perforation point in the plate. Mother Nature has created this perforation point. It's punched up from down below, but it's a weak point. We all understand how perforations work, so I shouldn't have to explain that to you. But this is over a vast area, and it would be a tremendous amount of force applied. So it seeks out the perforation points. In this case, it's Mammoth Mountain, Tom's Place, and right next to Tom's Place, right on the other side of this, quite literally on the other side of this small foothill or mountain, here's this airport, and here's our geothermal turbines, where humans have drilled it in, again, to this volcano, Long Valley, which is a supervolcano. They just elevated it to supervolcanic status about 4 months ago. We jump across the border, a lone 1.4, but it's really triangulated from Mammoth Lakes too. But it takes us across the border into Nevada. Take a look, or should I say across the border, it takes us right to the border. I mean, within a few hundred feet of the California border. There's something right here, the Volcanic Hills State Park. Volcanic Hills goes all the way over here, right to the edge. I look within 440 miles. Let's get a measurement from the earthquake over to the Volcanic Hills. 20 miles to the center of the Volcanic Hills, and they come all the way over to here, 14 miles. Definitely close enough to be related. Also, close enough to be related to Mono Lake Volcanic Field and Long Valley. See how it's triangulated between all three. But that's it. Those are the only earthquakes we have to report to you. So let's recap. Geysers, drill point, volcano. Up here to the north, clearly at a boiling pond, Mother Nature punch point, but another geothermal spot. Down here, right on the edge of Mammoth Mountain, Tom's Place, again, right next to the geothermal pumping operation for Long Valley. And jumping across the border, or right next to the border, at Volcanic Hills. Down here, drill point, and four sets of small quakes on the San Andreas, going up to near 3.0 in the middle. As we go over to the east, let's go over to the nuke test sites. Over to Alamo. Well, there's something interesting here. I always like to show it. Now, don't be alarmed. This is nothing to be alarmed about. They're not doing anything here now, just so you know, before I, you know, show you what I'm about to show you. All of these craters in the ground are different nuclear test sites. So they're not doing any nuke tests there now, but they have in the past done hundreds and hundreds of them, and it's led to a weak point in the crust. Here's one that the UK did here. We let the UK partner up with us to do nuke test here. April 22nd, 1983. 2 kilotons, so it's small. Small nuke, as opposed to the large nukes going up into the megaton level. That's thousands of kilotons. So we're on the edge of the nuke test site. Also, right here where the earthquake is, here, this is Area 51. Oh, yeah, I know. We're not going to get into that. But we're right on the edge of Area 51, Groom Lake, and we're right next to the nuke test sites. So humans have fractured the nuke test sites. Really, that's what's the ultimate cause of earthquakes seeking out these points. So if it had a random spot to seek out, it would seek out a random point. But if there's a drill point there, that then creates a spot for it to seek, this force that's going across the plate. Sounds like we just had something hit over in Indonesia. To go take a look at that in a second. Let's jump over here, now that you've seen the nuke test sites, and just quickly take a gander over into Utah. Fillmore, Utah. What's over in Fillmore? I love doing this. I could do this all day long. looking up locations. I don't know why I like it. Here we are. Ah, okay. Wow. Wow. Whoa. Look where we're at. So we're right next to Mineral Mountains Cove Fort. The Pleistocene Mineral Mountains Cove Fort volcanic field contains silicic lava domes in the mineral mountains and basaltic and andesite cinder cones. If I can read proper. And the earthquake's right on the flank of that. Look how big it is. That's a huge complex. We also have a basalt fissure to the south and up to the north. North Twin Peak and South Twin Peaks. We've got the Twin Peaks here. Uh-oh. Also up to the north, Black Rock Desert. Look at the lava flow here. Unmarked volcano at the cinders. So they call it the cinders, but that's Black Rock Desert. Okay. I'm glad I looked it up. Let's go over to the east and take a look here. So grab any one of the coordinates on this big stack at Farron. If I'm served correctly by this, this should take us in next to two features. Both features are interesting. Yeah. Okay. Same spot as yesterday. All right. Now we back it out. And we look down to the east by southeast, and all of this volcanic field here. Little Black Mountain, Temple of the Sun. Let's go take a look at the Temple of the Sun. Ah, it's like a sundial. Yeah, the leftover remnants of the core of a volcano. Same with this one. Over to the east, you can see the lava flows on those, and up to the north. I said there was two interesting features. So, I mean, that's interesting, right? But up to the north, all of these little square pads that we have here. Every single square pad, as I zoom in on it, you should be able to see the shadow of the oil well. So that's the pump. And they're all over the place. We can just, again, you get the picture. It just goes on and on. Goes through the town. Right, here's a spot where they're doing here's a reservoir, a quarry, and a bunch of drill points. I don't know if I'd want to drink that water, but it's a reservoir nonetheless. As we go further to the south, you see it doesn't stop. The pumping operations carry on. The pipelines carry on. And I think it carries on a little bit further right down to here. So we're just a hop, skip, and a jump. And they may have even opened this up further for exploration, or there may be nearby wells that I haven't found yet. It's not like I can get a great downloadable map that gives me all the wells all over the country. Okay, well, our big swarm is right next to a huge pumping operation and right on the flanks of a large volcanic field. Over to the east. East Carbon City, Utah. -3.3 kilometer depth. Is this like a quarry blast or an explosion misidentified? -3.3. I mean, it could be up inside of a mountain or something, or we could be high elevation here. Our elevation is 6,700 feet. But that's not 3 miles. Whoa, we're on the other side of the oil pumping operation, of course. Well, how far over to the east does the oil pumping operation go? Our imagery date as of 2015. Oh, man. Well, that's not going to really help us much when the pumping operations go over to here in 2015. Here, let's get a shot of one of the wells. There we are. So this is 2015 out here, and they're all over the place. I'm just wondering how far down to the east by southeast they've carried on. This is all pretty much a pristine area. Pretty sad to see that getting done, actually. So, 3 sets of earthquakes, 3 sets of quakes next to drill points or weak points created by Mother Nature. Just like up to the north next to Yellowstone, just like over in California, the only spots that really aren't associated with drill points or volcanoes right now are all in the northwest, and these lone 4 quakes here going down the creeping section of the San Andreas. Let's carry on, shall we? Let's go back over into California. I think I pretty much proved my case, though. I mean, by showing you all these, we can go, my case is that the weak points are getting hit, whether they're a volcanic drill point, regardless of what, whether they're Mother Nature made or man-made, that when this force is flowing across the plate, it hits these weak points, and it can become a forecastable thing that you can, quote-unquote, as the professionals would call it, prediction, that you could predict based upon that, or forecast is, again, a better terminology for it. You can get a probability to it on a daily basis. As we go down here, where should we start? The 0.1, does it even matter? This should come in next to Yubi Hebe Craters. We'll pull the coordinates and show you. I like looking up even the smallest microquake. Why? I don't know. Don't know. It's just something interesting. So I said Yubi Hebe Craters, right? Here's Yubi Hebe. Actually, we're a little closer to Ryan Craters. Ryan Craters and Yubi Hebe are the same. One's older than the other. This one has a bigger blast caldera out of it. Blast crater. And this is large. It goes out in both directions, the volcanic field itself. Down to the south, same thing. Ryan Craters, it's big, but they're doing mining there and some other stuff. Old geothermal was here. They don't have geothermal there now. So there are drill points there, but now they're doing mining. Okay, let's go out in the middle of this and then just look a mile to the east and 5 miles, or 5 miles to the east and a mile to the west. Kozo Junction, yet once again. Man, I feel like I'm best friends with this place. We're looking it up every day. Why are we going here every day? I thought earthquakes were random. It's a joke. So, Kozo Volcanic Field here. This is Smithsonian marked, and you can read it if you want to, but I'm more interested in the drill points at the volcano. So humans have come in and drilled into the volcano again to get steam, and we're getting hit with earthquakes. And I said we're going to go just a mile to the west and 5 miles to the east, right? So a mile to the west, where does that take us? It just takes us right to the edge of the volcanic field here, on the outside edge of one of these obsidian domes. And 5 miles to the east, right? Well, that takes us right over here, over far past the geothermal pumping operation, out here next to Volcano Butte. But you'll also note that there's unmarked buttes out here. So while Volcano Butte is marked, I mean, this one's not marked. And there are spatter cones of some kind. That one is, and this one is. Okay, well, we're on the edge of a volcanic field. No duh, it's been just one after the other that I've been showing you. As we go further down to the south tip of Sacramento Valley, or, well, San Joaquin Valley, sorry. San Joaquin, my California viewers will chastise me to no end if I call it South Sacramento. How dare I? How dare you? Somebody will send me some pistachio nuts from here again. Okay. Now, right here, look what's right next to this. Here's our earthquake. And all around here, all around Bakersfield, down to the south, up to the north. Take a look. Well, first, here's the earthquake epicenter itself. And backing it out, looks pretty innocuous. Right across town, this. All of these are different drill points, every single one of them, for oil and gas. And it just goes on and on. Ants on the ground. Huge. Now, are there any down here across town? Most likely, yes. Do I have them marked? No. Do I need to? No. I always look within 6 to 10 miles. Certainly, that's close enough. And if there's anything else nearby, I'm sure my viewers will let me know. You can leave a comment down below if you know of anything nearby here. So, there most likely is. I mean, with a pumping operation that size, it doesn't just go in this little circle here. Goes up and keeps going. And keeps going. And keeps going. And keeps going. Yeah, well, you start to see this when you see it every day. For me, it's not as shocking as some people when I read the comments down below. It's like, people are like, what? I can't believe it. I couldn't either. when you start to see that amount of drilling in a spot where we're concerned, quote unquote, about earthquake activity, like, look at this. First of all, look where we are. Here's the San Andreas, right? And then we get down here, and you zoom in, and it looks like a mountain range, doesn't it? I mean, it does. At this height, what is our eye? We're 32 miles up in space. We start zooming in, and we get down to, here we are at 35,000 feet, right? So you might be, here we are. There we go. There we are. 37,000 foot. So you'd be flying over in an airplane. You'd be looking down. You'd be like, oh, look at the sand dunes. Well, okay. Well, you go down to helicopter height. You're at 5,000 feet, and you can start to make it out. And we go in even further, and we're here now at 1,000 foot, and you got the picture. We're talking about major. The whole mountain range has been cut out. Every spot. Those aren't sand dunes. Those are drill points. And that's just one example here that goes all the way up to the spot that I showed you where we started here, next to Parkfield. So, back to this 1.7, clearly next to a drill point. Let's go down to the 1.9 at Chatsworth. I showed this in today's update earlier today, so I already know what's here, but I'll show you again. This should take us in right next to a graveyard. All right, there it is. Here's the graveyard. And right next to this, let me just roll this back just a little bit. And right here. Do you see all these pads? Yet once again, we've got geothermal actually going on here. Geothermal turbines placed out here with pipelines. And the pipelines go to drill points. Now that's not all that's nearby. Right here, oil and gas. And I'm talking big time. They've got big time drilling here. Every one of these pads all over the mountain sides. So oil and gas and geothermal right next to each other, right next to the quake. And these pumping operations go all the way down the hillsides here. And kind of end at the end right here. So this is where I think we're ending. Our imagery data as of 2018, so that's pretty recent. I mean, there may be some more right in here somewhere, but I mean, we're already close enough. That's like 3 miles away, maybe 4 or 5 miles at the most. So another drill point, just like this 1.9. Do you think it's a coincidence of the same size quakes at the drill points, at the oil pumping operations? I don't want to hear it's just fracking. When we have oil pumping operations getting hit regularly as forces flowing across the plate. Now, getting down into Southern California directly, this is the only other spot I would say would be fault zone related here. Now, this is on the Anza Gap slow slip section of the San Jacinto. And I'll show you the San Jacinto in the fault zone map. It's this red line here. So the smaller, thinner red line, as opposed to the thicker red line being the plate boundary. So this is moves daily. We've been watching it go for 2.5 years in a slow slip, as the professionals call it. Now, professionals say this will lead to a larger earthquake eventually here, pretty soon. Next few years, they say. Well, I would say that first things first, the energy has to build up here. It transfers over to Texas normally and goes over into Oklahoma. So right now we're building in Southern California. I would watch for the Texas-Oklahoma border region to come under stress from this activity flowing down into Southern California right now. So we have a swarm up north. Swarm up north indicates pressure is coming across, but I mean the predominance of this is going across straight from the coast over towards Yellowstone, down to Utah. The other portion of this is going down across California, down to Southern California. Both are going to be heading this way, over towards Oklahoma, over to the drill points in Oklahoma, where that lone 2.6 is standing out over at the Oklahoma fracking ops. One thing I would like to check before we go any further is the real-time tremor map. This is something that we have to check daily. Let me close all these other windows. This, and look at the tremors. Now, the tremors are small vibrations as the plate supposedly is shifting. Looking at 48 hours, you'll see where we left off last night, a diagonal line going from the coast of California up near Redding, north near Yreka. Then further to the north across Oregon, just a handful, three. Now, these are not earthquakes. These are just small vibrations as the plate moves. So there's only a handful. How many are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We've seen hundreds or even thousands of these happen. So to see 7 either means system outage, that the system is out and they're not reporting quakes or whatever, or tremors, I mean. Or it's gone quiet. And if it's stopped moving, that is, stopped vibrating, that's not good. That's the sign of a building event. Now, a 5 just hit up here. Same time that the 5 hits, the tremors stop on land. That's going to change. The tremors should pick up. The 5 has already hit here off the coast. That fulfills the forecast for this week already. So the only other thing we're waiting for is the coast of Washington to check in here. And if it does or if it doesn't, we've already seen the activity we would expect up in the northwest. So I'm going to go ahead and turn back on our 7-day feed. We're going to look at the last 7 days worth of earthquakes one more time. Now, let's see. There we go. Well, no, that's not what we have going on here. And a feed error. There we go. Now we've got the appropriate earthquakes. Take a look around the planet one more time. We get back over here. Oh, look, they took that 5.0 down to a 4.7 to 4.9. Not shocked by that. Well, at least they're going 4.9, then down to 4.7. That's good to know. But 4.7 coming in here, right next to it all. Now, there's already the eruption happening at Manam. It's just another one to throw into the bunch here. We've got a major disturbance happening down below the plate and up inside the plate. So first to push down below, deep earthquakes. Coming up through the plate, the untrained eye can even see it. Where's the cluster of earthquakes? Point it out. I mean, okay, so now that you get the picture of force flowing across the plate, you can be prepared for it the best you can. I would say watch it like you would watch a storm system and the jet stream. So you would know overall, generally, when a storm is coming your way by watching the jet stream. Now, the forecasting that comes in is to get it down to a fine point between our sets of quakes. When you've got something like this, I would look to the middle of the whole hot mess. So the middle fulcrum point between all the points that are moving. And if there's a lot of points moving, it just becomes that much more difficult to find the middle point. But there it is. I mean, it stands out. So we're spreading one way, spreading the other. We go to the middle, and the middle point where they all overlap, that's the spot that I watch. Then I watch the areas next to those. So if this whole region's moving, then I watch the region next to it that's quiet. It will transfer out of this region, the energy, and go out to the other regions adjacent to it. Pretty basic stuff here. Can you believe they denied it all? Yeah, there's no transfer of energy to adjacent regions. Yeah, when you push on something, it doesn't move. And if you push on something that's butting up against something else, and you apply enough force, yeah, it's not going to move both things. That's impossible. These people have never moved anything, obviously. So, we're not going to deny physics. We're going to not deny that the professionals were right. Do you get me on that? We're going to deny that the professionals were right. In other words, they were wrong. But you can't tell them they were wrong, so we're just going to have to deny that they were right. It'd be much easier for them to palate that. The time now is 11:07 p.m. Central Time. I will encourage you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared. I talk about this nightly, but I'm going to tell you again. Take the time to develop an earthquake plan, at least to think about it. Now, your earthquake plan should be twofold. One, take shelter, or two, evacuate. If the earthquake is big enough, you may want to get out of the structure you're in. Most people, if you're in a frame structure, you should be able to weather the storm in the structure itself. So that would just mean protecting yourself from falling objects, which means table or desk. But if you're concerned about the stability of your structure, or if you are in a stone or a brick stack structure of any kind, you're going to need to get out if the earthquake is large. So if you're going to go outside, do you have an emergency kit? Well, even if you're going to stay inside, do you have an emergency kit? And I want you to think about your kids and your grandkids. So I know a lot of you probably will think for yourself, but you know what? You could think for your kids and grandkids, have stuff that's in there for them as well. And you might even be able to have a bag for them directly, have their own emergency kit specifically designated for the kids or grandkids. And it'll have just a few more whimsical items in it that you, the adult, wouldn't need, but the kid might find very handy, and that would just be to keep them distracted or at least occupied while every adult around them is going into meltdown mode. So while you're actually prepared, the people around you are going to be going into meltdown. All right, just be ready for that. And anything else? I don't know. I don't know what else to tell you. You need to have things in the emergency kit, but that's going to be regional specific to you and weather specific depending on season. You know, the basic stuff, of course, flashlight and batteries and car keys and extra debit card and insurance card. Those are things that I think everybody in the world probably needs at this point. So you guys will come up with other better ideas to be prepared. 1109, what else do we have? Oh, one other thing. Dutchsinse merchandise. Dutchsinse merch. I'm not a good t-shirt salesman. Definitely can't sell a shirt. But if you want one, it's available. And we've got sweatshirts, t-shirts, stickers to meet everybody's price point. And again, it's just to support the operation, keep me going. You guys know I get shut down regularly. Well, I haven't been shut down in a week or two. That's actually kind of weird. But the numbers, I don't know what the deal is. Like, for instance, I got 300,000 subscribers on YouTube, and there's only 400 people. YouTube limits that. So, I've got 300,000 subscribers, 400 people. That is just, I'm not complaining. I'm just letting you know. I'm just shut down. They don't let me reach my audience. And so, if you want to support the operation, that's the way to do it. And then over here on Twitch, what's up and word up to everybody? Look, same number of viewers. It's starting to get a little weird. It is. It is starting to get a little strange to have the same number of viewers on each platform. It's like there's some greater control mechanism in place that's limiting viewers all across multiple platforms. But that would mean government collusion, and we know that could never happen. We know there's never groups of people that work together behind the scenes to do anything nefarious. That can't happen. That's just stuff for movies, isn't it? There's never groups of people that get away with stuff and keep secrets for decades, is there? No. That's a conspiracy. You guys have a good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. It is 11:11 p.m. Central Time. You want to talk conspiracy? That's a good time to talk it. I'm out of here.